Princeton University Press Audio presents Central Asia, A New History from the Imperial Conquests to the Present by Adeeb Khalid, read by Aaqil Ahmed. There is a PDF available to download with this audiobook containing the figures and diagrams found in the print and ebook editions. Whilst the PDF is not essential for understanding what follows, it may be helpful for context or further research. Introduction. When the collapse of the Soviet Union hurled the republics of Central Asia onto the global stage, the region was all but unknown to the outside world. Its complicated modern history had transpired away from the gaze of the world, with its events little noticed and the sources hidden away under lock and key. There was little expertise on the region, and outside observers had few ways of making sense of it. Initial reactions cast the new states as artificial, weak, lacking in any history or legitimacy, and with a potential for insecurity and instability. Commentators pulled out references from the past to make sense of the unexpected present. Hackneyed notions of the Silk Road and the Great Game were put to use to make sense of the newly emerged states. And exoticization was an easy fix. Commentary on Central Asia evoked vast, undulating grasslands filled with nomadic horsemen, the minarets and cupolas of medieval architecture, and natives in folkloric costumes. To be clear, this exoticization is not a peculiarly Western phenomenon. A Japanese documentary from the 1980s also cast the region in exotic light, with long shots of camels trudging into empty deserts to the New Age music of Kitaro. Today, Xinjiang is an exotic domestic destination for tourists from China proper, while in the wider Muslim world, the names Samarkand and Bukhara evoke medieval grandeur and luxury that again are not of the here and now. At its best, exoticism romanticizes Central Asia and places it beyond the reach of history. At its worst, it can render the region a blank slate on which one can inscribe anything one wishes. Central Asia has served as a locale of a number of Hollywood action movies featuring unsavory characters. While in the 2006 movie Borat, the British comedian Sacha Baron Cohen used the misadventures of a fictional Kazakh reporter visiting the United States to present a critique of Western naivety and gullibility. But the Kazakhstan represented in the film had nothing to do with the actual country. The ostensibly Kazakhstani scenes in the film were shot in Romania, and the film presented a completely made-up idea of Kazakhstan to its viewers. For Cohen, Kazakhstan's task was simply to embody the exotic, the inscrutable, the other. Some of this was perhaps inevitable. For much of the modern period, Central Asia was invisible to the outside world. The Eurasian landmass had been divided up over the course of the 19th century between the two contiguous land empires of Russia and China. On the political map of the world, Russia and China appeared as singular entities. It was easy to see each of them as somehow homogeneous, rather than the highly variegated imperial spaces they were. This was indeed what happened. For most of the existence of the Soviet Union, the outside world knew it simply as Russia. On my first visit to Washington, D.C., I was surprised to see a sign in the metro pointing to the Russian embassy. It was 1984 and the Cold War was getting quite hot. But American institutions, let alone the American public, could not tell the difference between Russia and the Soviet Union, and remained oblivious to the multinational character of their main adversary. Xinjiang was, if anything, even more invisible, simply a part of an inscrutable and exotic domain called China. Yet Central Asia was a distant backyard, even within each empire, and little known even to those who specialized on one or both of the empires. The Tsarist regime treated Central Asia as a militarily sensitive region and restricted travel by foreign subjects there. Its Soviet successors were even more secretive, and for most of the Soviet period, Central Asia was inaccessible to outsiders. I grew up in Pakistan, on the other side of the Pamir Mountains from Central Asia. Tashkent, the biggest city in Central Asia at the time, was a mere 1,200 kilometres from my hometown of Lahore, but it might as well have been on a different planet. Travel was very difficult and news of current developments in short supply. It was this sense of wonder about a land so near, yet so far, one so familiar yet very different, that first attracted me to Central Asia. The situation changed with the end of the Cold War and the dissolution of the Soviet Union. Central Asia is no longer isolated. In fact, it occupies a pivotal place in the Belt and Road Initiative, China's hugely ambitious plan to remake the transportation and commercial infrastructure of Eurasia. Yet, the view of the region as the distant heartland of Asia remains. Certainly in the public view, but also in policy circles, it remains an obscure place, the middle of nowhere, isolated from the rest of the world, or caught in some sort of time warp. This explains the constant invocation of the Silk Road, which heightens the sense that the region is best understood through its distant and exotic past, and the unstated assumption that its recent past and present are far less important or interesting. Nothing could be further from the facts. Instead of being a place that time forgot and where one can forget time, Central Asia has been a crossroads of history. It has experienced every current of modern history, every achievement of modernity, and every one of its disasters, and every extreme of the 20th and 21st centuries. The conquest of the region by the Tsarist, or Russian, and Qing empires marked a rupture in its history that needs to be taken seriously. Since then, Central Asia has experienced in succession colonial rule. Many projects of revolutionary nation and culture building and of remaking of the economy and society under communism. And, more recently, neoliberal globalization. For much of the 20th century, Central Asia was a laboratory of modernity and a showcase for the Soviet model of development. These experiences have transformed the region and its people in fundamental ways. Its landscapes have been put to industrial use, its vast spaces domesticated by roads, railways and airports, its cities reshaped, and its countryside brought under the plough as never before. The worldviews of its people and their ways of thinking about themselves, their communities and their states have undergone enormous changes. The idea of the nation transformed notions of community in significant ways. The modern period has also seen major demographic shifts. The population has increased manifold, and the region has witnessed the influx of new populations through migrations, deportations, or state-sponsored settlement. The large numbers of Russians and Han Chinese who now live in Central Asia are the clearest example of such movements. But many other groups, Germans, Poles, Ashkenazi Jews, Tatars, Hui, also known as Dungans, Koreans and Chechens, have appeared in Central Asia during the modern period. The 20th century brought universal literacy and massive transformations in the position of women in society. It also brought environmental disaster. The nuclear programs of both the Soviet Union and the People's Republic of China, PRC, were located in Central Asia, and both of them carried out open-air tests that had long-lasting effects on the population. In addition, the overuse of irrigation in Soviet Central Asia produced ecological disaster. The Aral Sea, once the fourth largest body of freshwater in the world, shrank drastically, transforming the climate and wreaking havoc on the health of those who live in its vicinity. For both good and ill, Central Asia is completely different from what it was in the middle of the 18th century. This audiobook is an attempt to provide a coherent narrative of these transformations. Central Asia is not at all exotic or timeless. Rather, it is very much the product of history, a history it shares with all other societies that experience colonialism, anti-colonialism, modernization, and development in the past couple of centuries. There are many ways to define Central Asia. The term coexists with others, such as Inner Asia or Central Eurasia, each of which has a different inflection and scope. We could define Central Asia expansively to include the entire Eurasian steppe and its neighbouring regions, extending from Hungary to Manchuria and stretching south to Afghanistan and even northern Pakistan and India. This is the definition adopted by the United Nations Economic, Social and Cultural Organization, UNESCO. In Soviet parlance, however, Central Asia comprised only the four republics of Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan. I have chosen a middle position that defines Central Asia as encompassing the five post-Soviet states and the Xinjiang region of the PRC. This Central Asia encompasses those predominantly Muslim societies that came under the rule of the overland empires of the Romanovs and the Qing from the late 18th century on. These societies were interconnected before their conquest as well, but the conquest put them on a peculiar trajectory, even as it distinguished them from those of their neighbours that were not conquered by those empires. In the 20th century, of course, both the Russian and the Chinese empires underwent revolutionary transformations that transformed their Central Asian territories in significant ways. The experience of the past two centuries has left these societies with much more in common with each other than with their other neighbours. The historical contingency that the Russian conquest stopped at the Amu Darya River accounts for the radically different path that Afghanistan took in the 20th century. For this reason, it does not belong in this story. For similar reasons, my Central Asia does not include the lands of the Tatars and Bashkirs, which are geographically connected to the steppe zone of Central Asia and inhabited by Turkic-speaking Muslims, but which have a much longer connection to the Russian state. I exclude Mongolia and Tibet from my purview for similar reasons. They are culturally quite different from the region that is the focus of this book, and their political histories have little in common with its history in the modern period. For all that, the Central Asia that I examine is not homogeneous. It is a frontier zone between nomadic and agrarian populations, a division seen as axiomatic by the region's own peoples. The river valleys of Transoxiana and the oasis of Altishah boast some of the most ancient cities in the world. Much of the surrounding steppe was home to nomadic populations until the 1930s. Nomadic and sedentary societies interacted throughout history, but they had different trajectories in the modern period, with the imperial powers treating them differently and subjecting them to different policies. Another axis of difference was imperial. The Russian and Chinese parts of Central Asia have experienced regimes of power that were both similar and different. The PRC modelled many of its policies in Xinjiang on Soviet precedents in Russian Central Asia, but took them in different directions. The audiobook is an experiment in writing an integrated history of modern Central Asia. The different political regimes in the Russian and Chinese zones mean that most of the chapters focus on one or the other half of Central Asia. However, I do offer a comparison between Soviet and Chinese policies of managing national difference, economic development, and social transformation as they affected Central Asia. This audiobook argues that imperial conquest thrust Central Asia into a new era of its history. That conquest marked a rupture with the past, which grew less important and less helpful in understanding the new era. Empires have been the most common form of political organisation in human history, and there had been plenty of empires in Central Asia's history. The conquests of the 18th and 19th century were different, however. They brought Central Asia under the control of large empires based outside the region. They completed the enclosure of the steppe that had been ongoing since the 7th century and reversed the long-term relationship between the region and its neighbours. In different ways, Russian and Chinese rule introduced new regimes of power to Central Asia. Imperial rule brought with it new institutional arrangements, tariff regimes, ways of entanglement in the world at large, and ultimately ways of seeing the world. The past did not disappear, of course, but the new order was significantly different. Central Asians related to the rest of the world in a different way. In the 20th century, both empires were overthrown and replaced by regimes of social mobilization that aimed at modernization and development. Central Asia was swept into those processes. Its modern history tells us a great deal about modernity, colonialism, secularism, communism, and development, some of the key phenomena that have shaped the world we live in. This audiobook suggests that this modern history is worth understanding in its own right, and it offers a first attempt at such an understanding. The period since the imperial conquests also produced new ways of thinking about self and community and created new forms of identification. The national labels with which contemporary Central Asians identify, Kazakh, Kyrgyz, Tajik, Turkmen, Uyghur, and Uzbek, emerged over the course of the 20th century, displacing other forms of community. The labels have long existed, but they acquired new meanings in the modern age. The Uzbeks of the 16th century are not the same as those of the 21st, for instance. And the term Turkmen has a different meaning today than it did in the 18th century. The shifting meaning of these terms and the emergence of new ways of identification is a major concern in this audiobook. This audiobook deals primarily with two imperial systems, those of Russia and China. They have shaped the context in which Central Asians have lived in the past 2.5 centuries, but their mutual relationship has never been stable or symmetrical. Both systems have changed enormously. I trace the enormous transformations that the two polities experienced: imperial collapse, revolution, civil war, and state-led transformation, both individually and in relation to each other. In the middle of the 18th century, China was much the wealthier and more powerful empire. The situation flipped in the 19th century, when Russia gained a military advantage as well as extraterritorial rights in China itself, while China, beset with threats both internal and external, risked being carved up like a melon by foreign powers, as the saying went. For much of the 20th century, China was the recipient of aid and advice from the Soviet Union. Today, China is a world power and more firmly in control of its Central Asian possessions than ever before, while Russian rule over Central Asia is no more. This imperial history also casts a long shadow on how we think and write about Central Asia. Overland empires did not have a formal separation between metropole and colony in the manner of overseas empires. A separation that makes the relationship between the imperial centre and the conquered territories more nebulous. It is easier to see overland empires as somehow more homogeneous than overseas empires. In the 20th century, Soviet rhetoric, seeking to minimise the imperial origins of the Soviet state, asserted that various non-Russian territories had joined the empire voluntarily, and that the Soviet Union existed on the basis of a deep friendship of peoples. Yet, as we shall hear shortly, Russia's possessions in Central Asia were thoroughly comparable to those of the overseas colonies of European empires. Since the demise of the Soviet Union, Central Asians have questioned the narrative to one degree or another, while the Russian public has been less receptive to the challenges. Today, it remembers the Tsarist Empire with fondness and pride, but is allergic to any mention of colonies or conquest. Soviet-era concepts thus create a post-Soviet amnesia about empire in Russia. China is a different matter altogether. From the late Qing on, all Chinese governments, regardless of their ideological orientation, have insisted that China is not an empire, but an indivisible nation-state with inviolable boundaries. The Qing dynasty collapsed in 1912 and was replaced by a republic, which only heightened the insistence on China's unity. Today, the People's Republic asserts that China, in its current boundaries, is the apotheosis of a Chinese nation-state that has existed throughout history as a single nation. This means that, in the words of an official proclamation of the State Council of the Republic, Xinjiang has, since the Western Han Dynasty, 206 BC to 24 AD, been an inseparable part of the unitary, multi-ethnic Chinese nation. According to this logic, Xinjiang is not part of Central Asia at all, but constitutes the so-called Western Regions, Xiyu, of a trans-historical Chinese nation-state. This uncompromising and teleological view of China and its relationship to Xinjiang lies at the heart of the conflict in Xinjiang that is at a critical stage as I write these lines, with millions of Uyghurs in extrajudicial detention for not being loyal enough Chinese. Viewing China from Central Asia, as I do in this audiobook, allows us to understand China in a new way. The China invoked by the Chinese government is a 20th century vision of the nation that subsumes a fraught history of numerous dynasties, many of which were established by peoples from Inner Asia, into a single narrative of an ever-present entity called China. This teleology does not fit well with the historical record, which is full of discontinuities and ruptures. One might equate China not with a single state, but with a political or cultural tradition. But even that continuity is problematic. Each new dynasty celebrated its novelty and its difference from its predecessors, rather than any continuity of a Chinese tradition. That tradition remained alien to lands beyond the central plains of China proper, Nadi. More importantly for our purposes, the territorial extent of the various dynastic states varied enormously, and few of them controlled the whole territory of China proper, let alone everything within the current boundaries of the PRC. The Tang Dynasty, 618 to 907, had extended its rule to what is now Xinjiang. After the collapse of the Tang, no dynasty based in China proper controlled any part of Central Asia until the Qing conquests of the 1750s. The novelty of Xinjiang to the Qing Imperium was underscored by its name, which means New Dominion. The current boundaries of China were created by the 18th century imperial conquest of a Manchu dynasty. It is with these conquests that I start this audiobook. Central Asia's history in the past 2.5 centuries has been affected by transformations that often originated elsewhere: imperial conquests, the Russian and Chinese revolutions, and the neoliberal revolution. This audiobook is about the ways Central Asians dealt with these transformations. I seek their agency both within and beyond the official institutions of the states that rule them. People act in given circumstances, but they act in their own ways. Those ways differ and are always singular. Different groups of Central Asians had different notions of what ought to be done and how society had to act. The period I cover in this audiobook has seen several monumental transformations: imperial conquest, revolutions, and both the building of socialism and its collapse, and each has produced new claims to leadership from new groups in society. There was plenty of contention within Central Asian societies, and I wish to convey that very clearly. In this audiobook, we will see Central Asians arguing with each other as much as they argue with the Russians or the Chinese. Central Asia stretches from the Caspian Sea in the west to the Altai Mountains in the east, and from the Kopek Darg Mountains in the south to deep into the steppe in the north. It is an extensive area, about the size of the United States west of the Mississippi, and it encompasses a great deal of geographic and environmental diversity. The fundamental fact about the region, however, is its great distance from open water. The continental pole, the point of the planet farthest from open water, lies at 46 degrees 17 minutes north and 86 degrees 40 minutes east, near the border between Xinjiang and Kazakhstan, 2,645 kilometers from the nearest coastline. The climate is continental, with extremes of heat and cold, and water is generally scarce. It means that large parts of the region are grassland or desert, and that agricultural and urban life are often dependent on irrigation. The region consists of a series of internal drainage basins, that is, areas in which rivers flow into inland seas or lakes rather than draining into oceans. The only exception is the northernmost reaches of Kazakhstan, which drain into the Irtysh River that flows into the Arctic Ocean. Central Asia has some of the tallest mountains in the world, but the rest of the terrain is rolling hills or flatlands. Snow melt from the mountains gives rise to the rivers, which flow westward to the Aral Sea. The river valleys create the possibility of irrigated agriculture. As noted in the table 0.1 in the accompanying PDF, they were the sites of some of the most ancient cities in the world. The aridity also creates large areas of desert, and to the north, vast stretches of grassland. Central Asia has both areas of dense population and vast tracts of sparsely populated or uninhabitable land. Its population of over 90 million is unevenly distributed, see table 0.1 and map 0.2. Before beginning the narrative, let us take a quick tour of the region to familiarise ourselves with the lay of the land and the geographic terminology used throughout the audiobook. Let us fly west from the port city, now known as Turkmenbasi, on the eastern shore of the Caspian Sea. It was also known as Krasnovodsk or Kazilsku until the 1990s. A vast desert called Karakum or Garagum, Black Sands, stretches out below us. To the south, running east to west, is the Kopek Darg mountain range, across which lies the Iranian plateau. Soon we reach the banks of the Amu Darya, Oxus to the Greeks and Jehun to the Arabs. Once we cross it, we are in Transoxiana, the land beyond the Oxus,
which the Arabs called Mawara al-Nahr, or Mawar al-Nahr, the land beyond the river. The term was used in all Islamicate languages to denote the region between the Amu and the Sir Daryas. A great portion of Transoxiana is also desert, called Kizilkum, or Kizilkum Red Sands. But lands along the banks of the two rivers and others that flow into them, Zarafshan, the gold bestower, Vakhshpanj and Sukhandarya, support agriculture and have long supported urban life. Samarkand and Bukhara sit smack in the middle of Transoxiana. Downriver, where the Amu emptied into the Aral Sea, lies Khwarazm, another ancient city and for many centuries a major commercial and political centre. Upriver, we find the fertile Fergana Valley, which today is the most densely populated part of Central Asia. As we fly farther east, we spy the largest mountain system in the world. To the southeast lies the Pamir Knot, called the Roof of the World, where a number of mountain chains come together. The Davos chain comes in from the southwest, the Karakoram and Himalayas stretch out eastward, and the Tin Shan Range, Celestial Mountains in Chinese, strikes out northward. This is inaccessible terrain that separates Central Asia from South Asia. The Tin Shan also cleaves Central Asia longitudinally into western and eastern halves. Let us stick to the west for a while longer. To the northeast of the Pamir Massif lies the Fergana Valley, which is surrounded on three sides by mountains. The western foothills of the Tian Shan chain are a lush area watered by a number of tributaries of the Sir Darya, which give the area its name, Jetisuv in Kyrgyz and Kazakh, and Semerechi in Russian, meaning seven rivers in either case. North of the Sir Darya, we are on the steppe proper, a vast, mostly flat area of grassland or desert that stretches north until it blends into the Siberian taiga. In medieval Islamic sources, it was called the Dasht-i-Kipchak, the Kipchak steppe, named after a nomadic Turkic group that dominated it at the time. In the modern period, it makes sense to call it the Kazakh steppe, since in that era it has been inhabited by Kazakhs. Most of it is a plateau, the central part of which is known by the name Betbakdala, Hungry Steppe, in testimony to the hardships that nature inflicts upon humans who try to live there. East of Jetisuv, however, we come upon another basin, called Dzungaria, after the nomadic people that occupied it until the 18th century. The Dzungars play an important role at the beginning of the story this audiobook relates. They were Mongol and never became Muslim. Dzungaria is a steppe grassland and the site of the continental pole of inaccessibility. Its southern boundaries is formed by the Tian Shan Range, south of which is another large internal drainage basin, that of the Tarim River. The Tarim arises in the Karakum Mountains and used to flow into the Lop Nor Lake. Much of this basin is another desert, called the Taklamakan. It is dotted with fertile oases, which give rise to cities in ancient times. The Tarim Basin is also known as Altishah, six cities, a term for the oasis cities in the basin, as well as eastern Turkestan. It is bounded on the south by the Kunlun Mountains, which separate it from the Tibet Plateau. To its east lies the Turfan Basin, a fault trough that houses the oasis of Turfan and Kumul. Descending to 155 metres below sea level, it is one of the lowest depressions in the world. It has a very hot and dry climate, but the presence of underground water makes irrigated agriculture possible. Here we are at the other end of Central Asia. For, to the east, the Turfan Basin connects to the Gansu Corridor, a string of oases along a narrow path between the Kunlun Mountains to the south and the Gobi Desert to the north, that leads down to the Yellow River Valley, Huanghe, and China proper. Central Asian sources use several terms for the lands beyond. Khitay for the area north of the Yellow River, once the land of the Khitans, Chin for the area south of that river, and Machin for the territory south of the Yangtze River. The Turfan Basin at the easternmost edge of Central Asia had long been in commercial contact with China. For the rest of Muslim Central Asia, China remained a distant and culturally alien region. As mentioned before, the Tin Shan Mountains divide Central Asia in two. Although the division has never prevented travel or other kinds of interaction, and the two regions are tied together by numerous cultural and economic links.
yet the two halves have often operated in different geopolitical arenas. Central Asia was often called Turkestan, the land of the Turks, and its two halves referred to as Western and Eastern Turkestan. In the 19th century, after the imperial conquests, they were often called Russian and Chinese Turkestan. These were geographical terms, not names of political entities, of course, but they nevertheless acknowledged a commonality between the two parts. In addition to the East-West or Chinese-Russian division, we should also posit a North-South division between the steppe lands and the lands of the oasis and irrigated agriculture. The division is very rough, but nevertheless useful to keep in mind, for most of the sedentary agrarian population of Central Asia existed in Khwarazm, Transoxiana, Fergana, and the oasis of Altishah, while the rest of the region, especially the steppe zone north of Transoxiana, remained predominantly nomadic until the 1930s. This quick tour also confronts us with another important issue that everyone interested in Central Asia faces. Central Asian place names have changed over time. They often have more than one version, and there are numerous ways of spelling them. The same applies to Central Asian personal names. The spelling depends on whether one transliterates the name of a place or a person from a Central Asian language or via Russian or Chinese. Transliterating names via Russian results in infelicities, so that H, which does not exist in Russian, becomes KH, and the sound represented by the English J is rendered by the unsightly and to non-Russian speakers incomprehensible jumble of DZH, while all sorts of other vowels get bent out of shape. Chinese versions of Central Asian names, based on a syllabic transcription, often render the originals completely unidentifiable. Ahmed becomes Aymaiti, and Ibrahim turns into Yibuli Ayin. In this audiobook, I use the names of people and places as they appear in Central Asian languages. Occasionally, I give two versions of a place name when both are in use. For the names of people, I use a common transliteration scheme for the period before the 1920s, when specific orthographies became established for different Central Asian languages. For the period after that, I transliterate names according to the language the person in question identified with most, recognizing all along that complete consistency is neither possible nor desirable. Finally, a note about the term Turkestan and its variants. Turkestan, literally the land of the Turks, was a generic term used in Central Asia and beyond for the territory north of the Amud Darya, where Turkic-speaking people predominated. The term was widespread enough that the Russians adopted it for the new province they established in 1865. From 1865 to 1924, Turkestan referred to a concrete administrative entity, but the older, more generic sense of the term never disappeared. In the 19th and early 20th centuries, conventional usage both locally and in Europe divided Central Asia into Western or Russian and Eastern or Chinese Turkestan, roughly along the Tin Shan. In the early 20th century, the Turkic-speaking Muslim subjects of the Qing began to use Eastern Turkestan as the name for their region. None of this would be worth a comment were it not for the insistence of the PRC that Eastern Turkestan is a term invented by foreign imperialists, with the aim of dismantling China and used today by alleged separatists and extremists. The only term the Chinese government allows is Xinjiang, spelt X-I-N-J-I-A-N-G. Even though the term contains the narrative of imperial conquest, it may not be translated into Uyghur. The Uyghur terms for the region is Xinjiang, the transliterated form of the Chinese name. Today, most Uyghurs use the term only under duress. In this audiobook, I use the term Xinjiang to refer only to the administrative entity of that name. When referring to the region in other contexts, I use Eastern Turkestan or Altishah, and I usually follow the usage preferred by my sources. Chapter 1. The Multiple Heritages of Central Asia. Modern Central Asia has been shaped by a long history of interactions between the peoples of the Eurasian steppe and those of the agrarian societies that ring it, China, India, Iran, and Europe. For environmental reasons, the steppe, the vast zone of grassland and desert that stretches from Hungary to Korea, cannot support a dense population. early human societies discovered that the best strategy for survival on the steppe was pastoral nomadism, in which animals, camels, sheep, cattle and horses, provide the basis of livelihood. Nomadic groups laid claim to distinct pasture lands and followed fixed migration routes between winter and summer pastures. Over the centuries, steppe nomads interacted with neighbouring sedentary societies through raiding, trading and conquest. The domestication of the horse gave nomads mobility and a military advantage for a millennium and a half. During this period, they built a number of empires on the steppe that could dictate terms to their sedentary neighbours and occasionally conquer them outright. Nomads were a constant presence on the frontiers of agrarian societies on Eurasia's edges, which found it almost impossible to control the vast spaces of the steppe. The agrarian empires saw nomads as barbarians and a problem to be solved. The Great Wall of China, built to keep the northern barbarians out and Chinese peasants in, is an apt indication of this attitude. The wall is equally apt as a metaphor for the relationship between the two worlds, because it never succeeded in separating them. Instead, they remained intertwined in a symbiotic and permeable relationship. The Great Wall sat in a borderland that was a perpetual arena of interaction. Many Chinese states were founded by barbarians from the north or northwest, even if their foreign origins were often covered up in historical narratives. We pick up the story in the mid-18th century, when this geopolitical relationship between the steppe and its neighbours began to flip as the sedentary empires on the fringes of the steppe began to first enclose and then conquer the steppe. For a millennium and a half, the steppe was ascendant. Beginning with the Xiongnu, steppe nomads created a number of empires that extracted trading rights or tribute from their neighbours and sometimes conquered them. Such empires had several features in common. They appeared around a charismatic leader who claimed divine sanction of his sovereignty and who was therefore able to knit various tribes, political units imagined along geographical lines, into viable confederations. The first major steppe empire was that of the Xiongnu, whom we know through the name that Chinese sources use for them. The empire lasted for well over 200 years, 3rd century BCE to 1st century CE, and featured substantial urban settlements and ramified administration. In the Western steppe, the Scythians and Sarmatians built empires about the same time. In the 6th and 7th centuries CE, a group of nomads called the Turk established another empire in what is now Mongolia. Its centre was the Orkhon Valley, and it left behind runic inscriptions that are the oldest surviving texts in any Turkic language. In the 8th century, another confederation of Turkic tribes formed the Uyghur Empire. Its name was to be revived in the 20th century as the national name for the Turkic Muslim population of Xinjiang. River valleys and oases, where sufficient amounts of water were available, gave rise to sedentary societies and states built on agriculture. Transoxiana and the oasis of the Tarim Basin were part of this agrarian world. The so-called Bactria-Margiana archaeological complex dates back to 2200 to 1700 BCE and was a contemporary of civilizations in Egypt, Anatolia and the Indus Valley. In 539 to 330 BCE, the Achaemenid Empire, based in the Iranian plateau, extended into Transoxiana, when the region was known as Sogdiana or Sugd. Alexander the Great defeated the Achaemenids, and Sogdiana became the easternmost part of his empire. He is supposed to have founded the city of Kujand as Alexandria Eskat, Alexandria the Fervest. Sogdiana was an independent Greco-Bactrian state in the 3rd century BCE before it fell to nomadic groups from the east, which eventually established the Kushan Empire that expanded south into India. Zoroaster was born in Sogdiana, and Zoroastrianism had a long career in Central Asia. The Kushans adopted Buddhism, and it was through them that it travelled to China. By the 1st century CE, these empires were linked by long-distance trade to China, India, and Iran. This trade is the basis of our contemporary cliché of the Silk Road. The term was coined in 1877 by the German geographer Ferdinand Freiherr von Richthofen, who used it to describe the routes along which Chinese silk was exported from the Han Empire 206 BCE to 220 CE to Central Asia. Since then, however, the term has expanded to cover all trade that ostensibly linked China to the West for several centuries, until it was displaced by maritime trade during Europe's Age of Discovery. This trade is supposed to have underpinned Central Asia's economy and made its civilization viable. There is much that is problematic about this view. The most lucrative trade moved along a north-south axis, and not from east to west, nor was the West, that is Europe, a significant partner in the east-west trade. Few goods and fewer people travel from one end of the road to the other. But more significantly for our purposes, the concept of the Silk Road turned Central Asia into simply a pathway, rather than a place of interest in its own right. The Silk Road works better as a metaphor of connectivity across cultures than as a description of a concrete historical phenomenon. We will make little use of the term in this audiobook. The nomads of the steppe spoke a variety of languages belonging to the Altaic family, which includes Mongolian, Tungusic, and a host of Turkic languages. Most of the sedentary population spoke various Indo-Iranian languages, which it shared with peoples in what are now Afghanistan and Iran. Transoxiana was always a frontier zone where the two linguistic families interacted the most intensely. It was the boundary between Iran and Turan, the land of the nomads. The Iran here is much more expansive than the present-day nation-state of that name. Much of the action of the Shahnameh, the Book of Kings, the epic poem by Abu al-Qasim Ferdowsi, commemorating the pre-Islamic Persian kings, is set not in present-day Iran, but in Transoxiana. Central Asia was also heterogeneous in its religious heritage. The nomads were shamanist. That is, they believed in the ability of certain individuals to travel back and forth between the material and spiritual worlds, either to enlist the support of various spiritual forces in pursuit of success in war, or to ensure people's health and well-being. Zoroastrianism and Buddhism were the prevalent religions among the sedentary population. In the 8th century, the Uyghurs adopted Manichaeism, and Nestorian Christianity flourished in the oasis cities of the region in the first millennium CE. The religious heritage of Central Asia was truly diverse. In the early 8th century, Transoxiana was conquered by Arab armies belonging to the Umayyad Caliphate. Islam had emerged in the oasis cities of Arabia in the early 7th century, and its adherents, also pastoral nomads, embarked on a series of astonishing conquests that brought about the demise of the Sassanid Empire in Iran, beat back the Byzantine Empire in Anatolia, and created an Arab state that stretched from Spain to Transoxiana by the early 8th century. The Arabs conquered Merv in 671 and Bukhara in 709 and annexed Transoxiana to their empire. The Arab conquest coincided with the greatest expansion of any Chinese dynasty until that point. The Tang controlled much of what is now Xinjiang. The two armies came face to face in 751 at the Battle of Talas in what is now Kyrgyzstan, where Tang forces were routed and the dynasty's westward expansion came to an end. In 750, the Umayyad dynasty was toppled by the Abbasids, a great deal of whose support came from insurgents in Iran and Transoxiana. Conversion to Islam was a long-term process, however, and it took several generations for the majority of the sedentary, Persian-speaking population to become Muslim. Nonetheless, by the 9th century, Transoxiana was solidly Muslim and had become an integral part of the Muslim world. Over the next two centuries, it produced a number of luminaries of the most fundamental importance in Islamic history. The sayings, hadith, of the Prophet Muhammad soon acquired a religious authority second only to that of the Quran, and their collection and categorization became a major preoccupation among scholars. Sunni Muslims hold six collections to be canonical. Two of the six compilers, Abu Ismail al-Bukhari and Abu Isa Muhammad al-Tirmidhi, were from Transoxiana, as were the influential jurist Abu Mansur Muhammad al-Maturidi and Burhan al-Din Abu al-Hasan al-Marginani. The mathematician Muhammad ibn Musa al-Khwarizmi, who founded algebra and whose name through its Latin corruption gives us the word algorithm, the astronomer Ibn Kafir al-Fargani,
and the great scientist Abu Nasr al-Muhammad al-Farabi, known as the second teacher after Aristotle, the rationalist philosopher Abu Ali ibn Sina, known in the West as Avicenna, and the geographer Abu Rayhan al-Biruni, figures of absolutely central importance in the history of Islamic civilization in its so-called classical age, were all born in the region. They were part of broader networks of travel and learning that served to make the cities of Transoxiana part of the heartland of the Muslim world. It was in this age that Bukhara and Samarkand acquired their reputation in the wider Muslim world. To a 13th century historian, Bukhara was the cupola of Islam in the Muslim East, like unto Baghdad, the capital of the Abbasid Caliphate, and its environs are adorned with the brightness of the light of doctors and jurists, and its surroundings embellished with the rarest of high attainments. Given its vast expanse, the caliphate was always largely decentralized, and regional governors had a great deal of leeway. By the middle of the 9th century, they had begun to act as they pleased, paying only the most nominal allegiance to the caliphate. It was in this context that a certain Ismail Samani, a local governor in Transoxiana, established his own dynasty with its capital at Bukhara. Ismail received investiture from the Abbasid Caliph, but he was to all intents and purposes a sovereign ruler. The Samanid dynasty that he founded presided over the rebirth of Persian as an Islamicate language. The great scholars we just encountered all wrote in Arabic, and therefore are often misidentified as Arabs. But neither they nor their compatriots ever used Arabic as a language of everyday intercourse. After the Arab conquests, Persian, the language of Transoxiana, had sunk to the level of vernacular. The Samanids reversed this trend and raised it to a language of administration and culture. Their court patronized the creation of a new literary language, which we now call New Persian, even though today it is over 1,000 years old. Written in Arabic script, with a large number of Arabic loanwords, it was Islamic in its sensibility. Its first great poet was Rudaki, but it was the Shahnameh, composed at the Samanid court, that laid the foundations of Persian as an Islamicate language of high culture. Islam spread more slowly in the neighbouring steppe. The first historical reports of large-scale conversion among the Turks date back from 960, when 200,000 tents, households, are said to have embraced Islam. By the end of the 10th century, Muslim Turks had become quite common and begun to assume political power. Turkic nomads belonging to the Ghaznavid and Karakhanid dynasties conquered Transoxiana and launched campaigns of conquest far and wide, going south into India and competing with other Muslim dynasties in eastern Iran and what is now Afghanistan. Other Turkic groups entered military service in dynasties in the Middle East and became an integral part of the political landscape in that region. Over the ensuing centuries, Turks were to found a number of dynasties in the Muslim world. The Seljuks fought the Byzantines and opened up Anatolia to Turkic settlement, where 2 centuries later, the Ottomans established what became a mighty world empire. Yet, the Islamicization of the steppe was a long drawn-out process that continued into the 18th century. Muslim societies interacted with non-Muslims along a long religious frontier that extended from Tibet to Dzungaria and beyond. The eastern oasis of Turfan and Kumul were majority Buddhist as late as 1420, when a Muslim envoy to the Ming court noted large idol temples of superb beauty in the two cities. Muslim sovereignty in Transoxiana and Altishah was broken in the early 12th century when the Fergana Valley and much of Altishah was conquered by a new dynasty called the Karakitay. They were nomads, most likely of Tungusic speech, who had escaped from the collapse of the Liao Empire in Manchuria and northeastern China in 1127. They imposed tribute on the cities and controlled the steppe for the next century, their only challenge coming from a new state in Khwarazm at the mouth of the Amu Darya. However, it was the eruption of the Mongol Empire in the early 13th century that truly transformed Central Asia. At the dawn of the century, a certain Temujin managed to unite all Mongol tribes behind him and launched on a series of conquests unrivaled in history. In 1206, he took the imperial title of Chinggis Khan
and presided over a series of astonishing military campaigns that brought much of Eurasia under Mongol rule. He conquered China and Central Asia before he died in 1227. His sons continued the conquests, and at its zenith, the Mongol Empire incorporated all of the steppe, Transoxiana, the Caucasus, all of Iran, and Eastern Europe. Both China and Russia were part of a single imperium in the 13th century. The Mongols achieved the apotheosis of nomadic empire building. Like all their predecessors, they used imperial charisma, a divine mandate, and an efficient system of military organization to achieve success. Unlike earlier nomadic empires, the Mongols conquered their sedentary neighbors and ruled them, commandeering bureaucrats from China and Iran to create systems of administration and taxation. The military campaigns were exceedingly violent, and Mongol brutality became proverbial across Eurasia. But the Mongol Empire also created new connections. Historians speak of a Pax Mongolica that turned most of Eurasia into a single economic zone and facilitated trade across it in an unprecedented fashion. The conquest also remade the politics of the region. They destroyed old elites and reshaped solidarities and affiliations across Eurasia. The Chinggisid family became the royal clan of all of Eurasia, and the principle that only descendants of Chinggis Khan through the male line had the right to rule was enshrined for a long time across the Mongol domains. In the Chinggisid dispensation, sovereignty belonged to the Chinggisid family as a whole. There was no primogeniture, and all descendants of Chinggis Khan through the male line were eligible to rule and bear the title of Khan. This turned out to be a built-in mechanism for instability. In his final testament, Chinggis had divided his realm into four parts, ulus, and bequeathed each of them to one of his four sons by his senior wife. The ancestral Mongol homelands and China went to his youngest son, Tolui, while Chinggis's grandson, Batu, whose father, Joki, preceded Chinggis, received the western steppe with its path to Europe. Chinggis had appointed his third son, Ogudai, as his heir and the great Khan, the leader of the dynasty and symbol of the unity of the empire. The empire continued to expand. Batu's forces subdued the Slavic principalities of Kievan Rus and threatened Hungary before turning back unconquered. His ulus, which came to be known as the Golden Horde, ruled over the agrarian settlements of Rus and the steppe north of the Black Sea. In 1258, Chinggis's grandson, Hulegu, invaded the Middle East and destroyed the Abbasid Caliphate, bringing all of Iran and the Fertile Crescent under Mongol rule. Another grandson, Kublai, expanded Mongol rule into southern China, finally defeating the Song dynasty in 1279. In 1260, during his campaigns, Kublai became the Great Khan. He moved the capital to Beijing and adopted a Chinese dynastic title, Yuan, for his empire. There had been several contentious struggles for the title of Great Khan, and after Kublai's death in 1294, the title lapsed. The different ulus grew apart and even came to blows. Mongol rule reshaped Central Asia over the course of the 13th century. While the region escaped lightly in comparison with some other regions conquered by the Mongols, the damage to both Central Asia's economy and its cultural traditions was still great. The older dynasties were wiped out, and the infrastructure of Islam suffered greatly. Chinggis Khan's actions in Bukhara in 1220 were emblematic of the initial phase of Mongol conquest. Having sacked the city, he rode into the main mosque and, mounting the pulpit, exclaimed to the assembled multitudes, "The countryside is empty of fodder. Fill our horses' bellies." Atta Malik Javani, a Muslim historian in Mongol employ, who is our best source for these events, recounts that the Mongols opened all the magazines in the town and began carrying off the grain, and they brought the cases in which Qurans were kept out into the courtyard of the mosque, where they cast the Qurans right and left and turned these cases into mangers for their horses, after which they circulated cups of wine and sent for the singing girls of the town to sing and dance for them, while the Mongols raised their voices to the tunes of their own songs. Meanwhile, the imams, sheikhs, sayyids, doctors and scholars of the age kept watch over their horses in the stable under the supervision of the equerries and executed their commands. In the end, however, the Mongols were largely indifferent to the religions of the people they conquered, and they did not actively persecute Islam. However, the religion was displaced from its position of authority, and Islamic law, Sharia, was replaced by the Chinggisid Yasa as the framework for law and political imagination. Yet within a century, the Mongol Empire had fragmented. In Central Asia, a new order emerged that preserved many aspects of the Chinggisid dispensation, but that was thoroughly indigenized to a Muslim Central Asia. Chinggis had given his second son, Chagatai, the lands of Altishar, Dzungaria, Transoxiana, and Khwarazm, essentially the Central Asia we will discuss in this audiobook, as his ulus. The name Chagatai was to have a long career in Central Asia, even if the trajectory of the actual ulus was turbulent, for Chagatai's brothers and their descendants coveted his territory and fought for it constantly. Around 1330, the Chagatayid Khan, Tamashirin, converted to Islam. He was not the first of his line to do so, but unlike his predecessors, he attempted to make Islam the official religion in his realm. That precipitated a revolt that overthrew him and caused a split in the Khanate, as other Chagatayids, loyal to Mongol traditions, raised a new Khan in the east, Altishar and the Turfan Basin. Tamashirin's line continued in Transoxiana in the west, with its solidly Muslim population. Thus, by the 1340s, the division between Western and Eastern Turkestan had become a reality. The East became known in Muslim sources as Mughalistan, the land of the Mongols, that is, of non-Muslim nomads. That religious difference did not last long, however, for the Eastern Khan, Tughluq Demir, converted to Islam along with other princes when he ascended the throne. By the middle of the 14th century, the Chagatai Khanate had been divided in two, but in both East and West its rulers had become Muslim and adopted the Turkic speech of the majority of their subjects. They were also dependent on the Turkic subjects for their military force. Only men claiming direct descent from Chinggis could rule, but there was no shortage of those, and there were constant struggles amongst Chinggis's progeny. This provided leaders of non-Chinggisid tribes, mostly Turkic Muslims, with the opportunity to play kingmaker. Chinggisid princes often became puppets for ambitious Turkic military leaders who were usually called emir. The most famous emir of all was Timur, who created his own world empire with its capital at Samarkand. Timur was a Muslim Turk of the Barlas tribe, who by 1370 had defeated his Turkic rivals and reduced the Chagatayid princes to figureheads. Yet he never claimed to be Khan or a ruler in his own right, but continued to rule in the name of the descendants of Chinggis Khan. After he married a Chinggisid princess in 1370, he took the title of Kurukhan, son-in-law, and he spent his career trying to emulate, if not surpass, Chinggis. He waged war on the various post-Mongol states, campaigning deep into the lands of the Golden Horde in present-day Russia and Ukraine, Syria and Iran, and Mughalistan, which he invaded four times. Other campaigns of his broke new ground. He invaded Anatolia, where he defeated Bayezid, the Sultan, and almost snuffed out the young Ottoman Empire, and India, where he infamously sacked Delhi in 1398. He was on a campaign against Ming China when he died in 1405. His career of conquest was comparable, both in its extent and its cruelty, to that of Chinggis Khan, and at its height, Timur's charisma had begun to rival that of Chinggis Khan. Yet this charisma was expressed in a different political language. To many contemporaries, and especially to his successors, Timur was Sahib Kiran, the lord of the auspicious conjunction, an astrological category most likely of Persian origin that had been thoroughly Islamicized by the 14th century. Timur's birth was supposed to have coincided with an auspicious conjunction of Mars and Jupiter. He was thus a divinely ordained messianic ruler foretold by astrological phenomena. Metaphorically, he also represented conjunctions both of nomadic military prowess with the ethical and administrative ideals of sedentary civilization and of Mongol warrior traditions with Islamic civilization. Timur could embody both the Chinggisid dispensation and a revitalized, if transformed, Islamicate political tradition. He was a Muslim sovereign who adorned his capital with magnificent mosques and patronized Islamic learning. The booty from his campaigns funded the creation of a magnificent imperial city, but he lived in the nomadic manner in luxurious tents outside the city. His persona had translated the Mongol heritage into an Islamic idiom. For this reason, he was to appeal to 20th century nation builders who could see the traditions of the steppe and the sown intertwined in his political legacy. Timur's empire did not outlast him, but his descendants held on to a sizable chunk of territory on both sides of the Amu Darya. They also drew away from the Chinggisid heritage and emphasized their Islamic credentials. Over the course of the 15th century, the Timurid court, first in Samarkand and then in Herat, in present-day Afghanistan, presided over an efflorescence of high culture, Islamicating its sensibility and uniquely Central Asian. Timur's grandson, Ulugbek, established madrasas, hospitals, and an observatory in Samarkand. He was an astronomer of considerable accomplishment, who established the exact angle of the Earth's elliptic plane and compiled the most comprehensive catalogue of stars since Ptolemy. The Timurid court also patronized the poet Jami, the painter Behzad, and the poet and statesman Alisher Navai. The most remarkable thing about the Timurid court was the emergence of Turkic as a language of high culture. Turkic languages had been committed to writing in the Arabic script as early as the 11th century. The Karakhanic statesman Yusuf of Balasagun wrote Kudadgu Bilig, Wisdom of Royal Glory, a mirror for princes, and Mahmud of Kashgar compiled a compendium of the language of the Turks in Arabic in Baghdad. However, it was at the Timurid court that Turkic became a fully respectable literary language, and Navai was its first exponent. This literary standard was called Chagatai. At about the same time, a different literary variant of Turkic was crystallizing at the Ottoman court in Istanbul. Chagatai and Ottoman developed in parallel as Eastern and Western Turkic. They were both Islamicate in their sensibility and highly ornate, with large numbers of loanwords from Persian and Arabic. They operated as media for the expression of high culture rather than as modes of quotidian intercourse, with which they had little in common. Persian continued to be the language of expression in Transoxiana, but Turkic now took its place alongside it. The high culture, poetry, historiography, painting, and courtly manners produced at the Timurid court in the 15th century was to have a lasting legacy in Central Asia and beyond. The Timurid dynasty was overthrown at the dawn of the 16th century by a Chinggisid restoration brought about by migration come conquest by Chinggisid nomads from the Ulus of Joki, also known as the Golden Horde. That Khanate had followed a trajectory similar to that of its Chagatayid counterpart. In 1327, its Khan, Uzbek, accepted Islam, after which the Khanate became known as the Ulus of Uzbek. It began to weaken and fragment, as internecine warfare amongst various claimants to the throne destroyed all semblance of political cohesion. The Rus principalities became ever more independent, while Muslim and Turkic-speaking successor states emerged in the Crimea and on the Volga. The eastern part of the Ulus of Uzbek remained predominantly nomadic. In the 15th century, Abul Khair Khan, a descendant of Joshi's fifth son, Shiban, had established himself as a powerful ruler, but his state fell apart upon his death and his followers scattered. At the end of the 15th century, his grandson, Muhammad Shibani Khan, led between 200,000 and 400,000 followers south into Transoxiana, where they ousted the Timurids and established their own Uzbek state in Transoxiana. One of the Timurid princes who was driven out was called Zahiruddin Muhammad Babur. He escaped with a handful of followers to Kabul. He found fame and fortune in India, where he founded the Mughal Empire that lasted until 1857. The Mughals called themselves Timurids and remained very conscious of their Timurid and Central Asian heritage. Large-scale nomadic migrations that often turned into invasions and conquest had been a key feature of Eurasian history since antiquity. The Uzbek invasion, migration, was one of the last. Shibani Khan's conquest had restored Chinggisid rule over Transoxiana, but it did not undo the cultural transformations of the Timurid era. Like the Timurids, the Shibanids were thoroughly Islamic and patronized Islamic elites. The Shimanid state was a highly decentralized tribal confederacy, but Bukhara was the capital and regained a sense of primacy in Transoxiana as a center of commerce and learning. The high point of the dynasty was the reign of Abdullah Khan II, which saw the construction of a number of madrasas and caravanserais in Bukhara. The Shibanid conquest also transformed the demographics of Transoxiana, implanting a large Turkic population there, many of whose members sedentarized and took up agriculture. Persian remained the language of learning and administration, but the implantation of a Turkic population was to change the linguistic situation in the long term. The Shibanids were overthrown in their turn in 1598 by another Chinggisid dynasty from the Joshid Ulus. That turn of events had everything to do with the final collapse of the Golden Horde. Muscovy had emerged as the most powerful amongst the Rus principalities conquered by the Mongols in the 1240s. As the Golden Horde weakened, Muscovy had begun to turn the tables on its former masters. As early as 1397, certain Tatar princes had become the vassals of Muscovy. As the 16th century dawned, Muscovy was dictating terms to the Khanate of Kazan on the Volga. Then, in 1547, Grand Prince Ivan IV, the Terrible, of Muscovy took the title of Tsar, with its imperial connotations, a clear sign of his renunciation of all connections to the steppe political tradition. In 1552, he stormed Kazan and annexed it. It was a Russian reconquista, and historians often see it as the founding of what became the Russian Empire. 4 years later, Ivan marched his armies down the Volga to Astrakhan, the seat of another successor state of the Golden Horde, and annexed it. Muscovy had gained a foothold on the Caspian. Some members of Astrakhan's ruling family fled to Transoxiana, where, a generation later, during a time of dynastic crisis, they managed to dethrone the Shibanids. Chinggisid rule continued in Transoxiana under a new dynasty. Not everyone had agreed with Shibani Khan's move to the south. Other followers of Abul Kher seceded and stayed behind in the north under the leadership of Jani Beg and Jirai Khans, both of Chinggisid descent. These followers came to be known as Kazakh. They remained nomadic and roamed over a large swath of territory north of the Sirdarya from the Ural River to the west to Lake Balkhash in the east, where they were neighbours to the Dzungars, western Mongols who had adopted Buddhism. For two centuries, the Kazakhs were a major force in Eurasian politics, having relations with Muscovy in the west, the Dzungars in the east, and Transoxiana's Uzbeks in the south, as well as controlling the trade routes that linked them. In the 17th century then, Chinggisid dynasties ruled all of Central Asia except the Dzungar steppe. The new political order that took shape after the Chinggisid restoration was highly decentralized. In the Kazakh steppe, the leading Khans controlled their followers in cooperation with other descendants of Genghis Khan. By the early 18th century, the Kazakh steppe had been divided among three polities called Juz, usually translated as horde in Western literature. They were the junior horde, Kishi Juz, middle horde, Orta Juz, and senior horde, Uli Juz. The city-based states of Transoxiana and Mughalistan were likewise decentralized. The Khans were senior members of the Chinggisid dynasty. They had to deal with other Chinggisids as well as with other non-Chinggisid Turkic tribes who provided the state's military manpower. The Turkic military elite, the emirs, expected a share of the revenues extracted from agriculture and trade, and they could always switch allegiance from one Chinggisid to another. This made for low state capacity and perpetual political instability. The period after the Chinggisid restoration is often seen as one of isolation and decline. The rise of European maritime trade is supposed to have dealt the Silk Road a mortal blow by shifting trans-Eurasian trade to oceans and thereby consigned Central Asia to a centuries-long decline. The basic assumptions behind this paradigm have been thoroughly questioned in recent scholarship, but it retains a tenacious hold on our imaginations. Scholars have documented the continuing strength of Eurasian trade that linked Central Asia to India in the south, China in the east, Russia in the north, and Iran in the southwest. Trade between Russia and China also passed through the steppe. Trade across the Eurasian steppe was, in fact, of long standing. The principalities of Rus had first emerged in the 9th century as trading stations established by mostly Scandinavian merchants to control trade that brought Central Asian and Middle Eastern silver to Europe. That trade never collapsed. In fact, protecting the trade routes was a major reason for Russian expansion on the steppe in the 18th century. For China too, the Central Asian trade was significant, enough for the Ming dynasty, which replaced the Mongol Yuan dynasty in 1368, to control it by restricting the number of merchants allowed into China. Imperial attempts at controlling trade will play a large part in the story this audiobook tells. The Chinggisid dispensation held, but it was being challenged by another kind of charisma. Timur was one example of this, another resided in Islam. The traumas of the Mongol conquest and the destruction that accompanied it had given rise to numerous religious movements that ranged from pietistic through millenarian to antinomian. The 15th century saw the consolidation of Sufi networks across Central Asia. Sufism is a complex phenomenon, often problematically glossed as Islamic mysticism, in which initiates seek proximity to the divine through rituals of remembrance of God, zikr, and mediation, muraqaba. Sufism was communal. The seeker was initiated into a path, tariqa, by a master, whose authority lay in his lineage. The master-disciple relationship was all important, and it created intense loyalties. Across generations, the master-disciple links turned into multiple chains of transmission, silsila, each with its own rituals and modes of interpretation. The troublous times of the Mongol invasion produced all manner of Sufi orders. By the 15th century, such orders had emerged as forms of both religious practice and social organization. Sufi masters, sheikhs, could accumulate great influence as advisors to rulers, which could turn into landed wealth. Central Asia was the birthplace of some of the most prominent Sufi orders in the Muslim world. The Naqshbandi order, founded by Bahauddin Naqshband, was to spread across the world. His disciples were responsible for the conversion of many Chagatayid rulers. The Sufis offered moral advice to the newly Islamicized Chagatayid rulers, and thereby gain political and monetary capital. But they could also present themselves as alternative sources of authority and vie for political power. By the turn of the 16th century, the caravan of religions that had passed through Central Asia in the previous millennium was a thing of the past. The agrarian zones of Transoxiana and Altishara were predominantly Muslim. The steppe remained a religious frontier, with Buddhism dominant in Dzungaria, whilst Islam had made deep inroads amongst steppe nomads. Islam was thoroughly indigenized, however, and had become a crucial marker of community and identity. Communities remembered their conversion to Islam not through historical narratives of invasion, conquest and conversion, but through myths of origin that conflated the conversion of rulers with the formation of a new Muslim community. The conversion was usually the work of holy men, usually Sufi masters, whose proximity to God endowed them with the ability to perform miracles. Satuk Bugra Khan, the Karakhanid ruler of the Kashgar oasis, is reputed to be the first Turkic prince to convert to Islam. He secretly became a Muslim in his youth after contact with merchants from Transoxiana. He then rebelled against his uncle, the ruler, dethroned him and converted his subjects to Islam. Uzbek Khan, the Chinggisid ruler of the Golden Horde, was at a Mongol drinking ceremony when four holy men arrived and invited him to convert to Islam. The Khan ordered his shamans to debate the newcomers. The debates turned into a competition of miracles. The two parties agreed to a trial by fire. One member of each party would enter an oven fired with 10 cartloads of tamarisk branches, and whoever emerges without being burned, his religion will be true. When the time came, Baba Tuklas, one of the Muslim holy men, volunteered for the ordeal. He walked into the oven, reciting the Sufi zikr, and survived, while his counterpart had to be forced into the oven and was instantly consumed by the fire. The Khan and all those present became Muslims. Tughluq Timur, the Chagatayid Khan of Mughalistan, met a certain Sheikh Jamaluddin when he was still a young man. Impressed by the meeting, he promised to become a Muslim if he ever became Khan. By the time that happened, Jamaluddin had died, but his son, Arshad Uddin, reminded the Khan of his promise. Tughluq Timur kept his promise and became a Muslim, along with all but one of his princes. The one skeptic was a man called Jaras, who insisted that he would convert only if Jamaluddin could overpower one of his champion wrestlers. Arshad Uddin duly defeated the man with a single blow, upon which a great outcry arose amongst the assemblage. That day, 120,000 people shaved their heads and became Muslim. the Khan circumcised himself and the light of Islam eradicated the darkness of heathenism and spread throughout the territory of Chagatai Khan. In the 11th century, Mahmud Kashgari had declared that the Turks all trace back to Turk, the son of Japheth, son of Noah. And that story became axiomatic in all Muslim societies in Central Asia. According to Islamic belief, Adam and Noah were the first among a large number of messengers that God had sent to humanity as bearers of divine guidance. They were part of a chain of divine intervention in human life that culminated with Muhammad, the seal of the prophets. The children of Japheth were thus Muslims from the beginning, but they had fallen off the true path and ceased being Muslim. Their conversion at the hand of sacred figures then became merely a return to a prior condition. Other myths place the mausoleum of Ali, the son-in-law of the Prophet Muhammad, in Mazar-i-Sharif in present-day Afghanistan, or in Shahi Mardan in the Fergana Valley. A mountain peak near the latter site is called Solomon's Throne and reputed to be the place where Solomon first turned to God. Such reliquary sites dissolved time and space and connected Central Asia to the core of the Islamic tradition. It's important to remember that in this age, being Muslim was a matter of belonging to a community that was innately Muslim, not a matter of individual belief. What Islam meant in communal life was always open to interpretation and hence contestation. The social and political effects of Islam were always a matter of struggle between different forces. It was the ever-shifting relations between those who wielded political power and those who possessed the authority to interpret Islam, the scholars, the ulama, the learned, and the Sufis, that determined what Islam meant at a given historical moment. The changing interpretations of Islam and contestations over them are a major theme in this audiobook. This breakneck speed overview of Central Asia's history up to the 18th century was meant to introduce certain key features of the heritage that Central Asians possessed as they entered the modern period. Multiple legacies, those of ancient urban life in the oases, steppe nomadism, Islam, and the Chinggisid Empire coexisted. Central Asians made sense of their own societies through a number of binaries: Turk versus Tajik, nomad versus sedentary, and the steppe versus the sown. These were important to the cultural imagination of Central Asia, but they should not be confused with social reality, which was always more complicated. In Transoxiana, not only did nomads and agriculturists live in close proximity, but many nomads also practiced agriculture. The linguistic situation was equally complex. Persian had become a language of high culture by the 11th century, as had Chagatai Turkic by the 15th. In both cases, the written language was far from ordinary speech, which varied enormously across dialects. Writing was a specialized activity. Written texts were meant as much to show virtuosity and a mastery of cultural codes as to convey meaning. Persian and Chagatai shared a number of cultural models, a common universe of meaning and symbolism, and a common vocabulary. It is more fruitful to think of Central Asian culture in the early modern age as Turco-Persian. Persian was far less important amongst the Kazakhs, and by the 18th century, its use was declining in Khwarezm and Altishahr as well. Many people, especially in Transoxiana, were bilingual, but it was the common set of cultural references and practices across the linguistic divide that made the culture Turco-Persian. Empire. On a wintry day in February 1881, the Russian Foreign Minister Nikolai Gierz shook hands with the Qing diplomat Zhong Jize as the two signed a treaty bringing the so-called Ili crisis to an end. The crisis had involved territory in the Ili region of Central Asia that was claimed by China but had been occupied by Russia in 1870 during the uprising that had vanquished Qing rule in Central Asia. The Treaty of St. Petersburg formalized the means of the region's return to China. The crisis is remembered today mostly because it was the one occasion in the 19th century where the beleaguered Qing Empire came out ahead in a diplomatic tussle with a European power. However, the treaty was also a significant landmark in the history of Central Asia. By creating a stable border between the two empires, now subject to international law, the treaty formalized the division of Central Asia between them. The steppe had been enclosed. The division of Central Asia between Russian and Chinese zones was to prove quite enduring. The boundary marked out in St. Petersburg exists more or less even today, though both the Russian and Qing empires are long gone. Yet the process that led to this division was long and complex, and we should start by making sense of it before exploring the implications of that division for Central Asia. We will be operating in a world in which empires were the normal form of political life, a world with its own logic that we will need to understand on its own terms. And we will see that very little about the rise of these two empires in Central Asia was foretold. Contingencies and accidents had as much as anything else to do with the shape that Central Asia took in the Age of Empire. Chapter 2. The Manchu Conquest of Eastern Turkestan. Between 1755 and 1759, the armies of the Manchu Empire overran Sungaria and Altishar and incorporated the Muslims of Eastern Turkestan into a China-based political order, which is shown in map 2.1 on the downloadable PDF. The Manchus had conquered China in the first half of the 17th century and established a Qing dynasty. At about the same time, the Western Mongols of the Dzungar steppe had established one last steppe empire. The two contended for power for a century before the Qing, which had far greater resources extracted from the agrarian economy of China, was able to annihilate the Dzungars in a series of lightning-quick victories in the 1750s. The Dzungars had ruled over Altishar for several decades at that point, but it now became part of the Qing Empire. A conflict between two inner Asian empires had thus made Xinjiang a part of China. Bitter rivalries among Muslim elites of Altishar had brought the region under Dzungar rule. By the middle of the 17th century, the Chinggisid dispensation was being challenged from a number of directions. The Sufi orders that had emerged from the upheavals of the Mongol conquest had acquired a great deal of wealth and influence. Sufi masters functioned as spiritual guides to rulers, giving them another layer of legitimacy. In return, the masters enjoyed grants of land and revenue. The most important Sufi figures in Altishar were the descendants of the Naqshbandi master Ahmed Kasani, known as Makhdum-i-Azm, the Great Master, who moved to Altishar from Transoxiana in the 1580s and acquired great influence at the Chagatayid court in Yarkand. Two lineages, coming from the Makhdum-i-Azm's different sons, soon began to compete for influence and followers. During the 1670s, Afak Hoxha, the eponymous head of the Afaki branch, lost the favour of the Chagatayid ruler of Yarkand and was forced into exile. He spent a decade proselytising in Kashmir, Tibet and Gansu. During his travels, he is supposed to have met Noang Lobsang Jantz, the fifth Dalai Lama, in person. We learn from a much later hagiographical account that the Hoxha and the Lama had a competition of miracles that, unsurprisingly, Afak Hoxha won handily. Astonished, the Dalai Lama asked Afak Hoxha who he was and where he came from. "I am a scholar and a Hoxha of the Muslim tribe," he replied. "Specifically, the people of Kashgar and Yarkand are my disciples and devotees. Recently, someone came and deprived me of these cities and drove me out. My request is that you instruct someone to restore this homeland of mine into my hands." The Dalai Lama was a forceful ruler who had unified most of Tibet under a reformist brand of Buddhism and whose spiritual influence extended into Western Mongolia. He told Afak Hoxha that while it was difficult for an army to go to Altishar from Tibet, he would be happy to have his Mongol disciples provide assistance. He wrote a letter to Galden Khan, the ruler of the Dzungars, asking him to deliver the two cities to Afak Hoxha. The Dzungars were a loose confederation of Western Mongol tribes in the lands north of the Tian Shan Mountains that had been united into a single state by Batur Hongtaiji in 1635. They came to control the long-distance trade among Russia, Transoxiana and China. Fueled by this trade, the new state succeeded quite spectacularly. Over the next decades, the Dzungars built walled cities, expanded agriculture and trade, and accumulated enough resources to equip their armies with cannons and gunpowder, much of which was produced locally. They adopted Tibetan Buddhism and created a written language. Like all steppe empires, they were expansionist. Galden obliged the Dalai Lama and drove out Ismail Khan, the last Chagatayid ruler of Yarkand. He placed Afak Hoxha on the throne and left him to his own devices in return for an annual tribute. A later Eastern Turkestani source suggests that an annual tribute of 48,000 tengas, ounces of silver, was levied on Kashgar and was collected by Dzungar missions that arrived every harvest season. There does not seem to have been a permanent garrison stationed in Altishar. A Sufi figure thus acquired unprecedented temporal power in Altishar under the tutelage of Buddhist nomads. The enduring stereotype that religion and politics are completely intertwined in Islam is historically untenable. For most of Islamic history, religious and political authority have resided in different groups, and the relationship between Islam and power has been quite fluid. Religious authority belonged to individuals distinguished by their learning and lineage, which created a certain charisma. By the 17th century, the earlier divides between the legal scholars, ulama, and the Sufis had largely been bridged by the rise of Sufi orders such as Naqshbandiya that emphasized engagement with the world rather than its renunciation as the correct path to God. Kingship, however, retained its aura. The possession of the throne could often be its own justification, and especially in the post-Mongol dispensation, Chinggisid descent was a basic requirement of legitimacy. The ulama were willing to consider legitimate all rulers who permitted them to enforce the sharia, but the situation was always dynamic. The Khojas of Altishar had gained their wealth and influence by advising Chinggisid rulers, but had then developed greater ambitions. Afat Khoja, therefore, represents one end of the spectrum, in which the Sufi Ishan, master, becomes the king. Sufi ritual became part of public life, and Sufi shrines and lodges the prime of political power, all under the suzerainty of the Dzungars. Things fell apart pretty quickly after Afat Khoja's death in 1694, however, as his two sons from different marriages fought for control. The Chagatayids attempted a comeback, but it was the Ishaki Khojas, the great rivals of the Afakis, who came out ahead. The Dzungars placed their leader, Danial Khoja, on the throne and deported members of Afat Khoja's lineage to the Dzungar capital in Gulja, where they remained as hostages. The Dzungars were happy to extract revenue from Altishar, but otherwise let it be. But if the burden of Dzungar rule sat lightly on Altishar, the Dzungar state was keen to develop agriculture in its heartland to have regular source of grain. It moved a group of peasants from Altishah north to Dzungaria, where they constructed irrigation channels and worked the land. This community acquired the name of Taranchi, agriculturist, when its members settled in the north, which was largely nomadic and non-Muslim. They were the first Turkic-speaking Muslim population in the steppe lands of Dzungaria. The Dzungars' expansion also brought them into conflict with the Qing. Manchu warriors had established a dynasty when they overthrew the Ming and conquered China at about the same time when the Dzungars were consolidating their state. The Manchus shared many inner Asian traditions with the steppe. During the early stages of their conquest, they had subdued eastern Mongol tribes and incorporated them into the empire as military elite. Nurhasi, the founder of the Qing, married the daughter of a Mongol chief, and intermarriage between the imperial family and Mongol nobles became common. The Qing came up with a fascinating synthesis of inner Asian political ideology and Chinese methods of organization to run the most populous empire of the time. The Qing was a dynastic empire run by a coalition of Manchu and Mongol warriors who saw themselves as distinct from the various subject populations they had conquered. Their relations with the Dzungars began amicably enough, with the Dzungars sending a diplomatic mission to Beijing in 1653, but the relations soon deteriorated. The Qing expected the Dzungars to behave as vassals, but Galdan, the conqueror of Altishar, had greater ambitions. Matters came to a head, and the first of many Qing-Dzungar wars began in 1687. The Qing, with the resources of a vast agrarian empire at its command, held the advantage, but distance and space, as well as speed and mobility, favoured the Dzungars, who were able to ward off the Qing time and time again. The Dzungars were a constant thorn in the side of the Qing, but the latter realized the danger of imperial overreach and spent several decades building up defenses and laying out military routes in the west. This consolidation took Qing influence into eastern Turkestan. The Muslim beygs of Kumul and Turfan became vassals and were incorporated into the banner system of military administration. The death of the Dzungar ruler, Galdan Sereng, in 1745 touched off a succession struggle that gave the Qing an opening. When Amr Sana, one of the contenders, sought Qing help in 1755, the Chenlong Emperor was happy to oblige, and Qing armies defeated Amarasana's rival, the Wachi. However, Amarasana was not content to be a Qing vassal and rose up in revolt. At this, Chenlong seems to have come to the end of his patience. He ordered a full-blown invasion of Dzungar lands with the aim of solving the problem once and for all. "Show no mercy at all to the rebels," he commanded. "Only the old and weak should be saved. Our previous military campaigns were too lenient. If we act as before, our troops will withdraw and further trouble will occur." It was an enormous campaign, with immensely long supply lines across inhospitable territory. But the Qing armies pulled it off. A series of battles over the next 2 years destroyed the Dzungars as a people. Qing armies killed a fifth of the male population and distributed Dzungar women and children as servants to the commanders. Another two-fifths of the Dzungars died of smallpox, and the rest fled westwards. Dzungaria was largely depopulated and annexed to the Qing. With this policy, Peter Perdue, the leading historian of the era, writes, the Qing succeeded in imposing a final solution to China's northwest frontier problems. Qing expansion might have stopped at this point, but circumstances conspired to keep it going. The Dzungars held Afak Hoxha's grandsons, Burhan ud-Din and Jahan, as hostages in Gulja. The Qing freed them and gave them logistical support to establish them as Qing vassals in Altishah. Upon Amarasana's revolt, however, the brothers also renounced their allegiance to the Qing and sought to establish power in their own names. The Chenglong Emperor authorized a punitive expedition, and over the next 2 years, Qing armies chased the Hoxhas and their supporters across Altishah and into western Turkestan. The brothers found refuge with Sultan Shah, the ruler of Badakhshan, in what is now northern Afghanistan, but that proved only a temporary reprieve. As Qing armies arrived in hot pursuit, Sultan Shah dragged his feet. But he ultimately had the brothers killed and delivered up the head of Hoxha Jahan to the Manchus. The trophy was taken to Beijing and ceremonially presented to the emperor before being put on display on the main gate of the Forbidden City. Chasing the two Hoxhas had brought Qing forces farther west than any China-based armies had gone in 1,000 years. Qing armies camped on the outskirts of Tashkent, while one unit reached the town of Talas, the scene of a famous battle a millennium earlier between Chinese and Arab forces. Qing forces sought submission from local rulers wherever they went. By the time the campaign was called off, several Kazakh and Kyrgyz tribes, the ruler of the new state of Kokand in the Fergana Valley, and numerous petty rulers from far away as Badakhshan, Chitral and Baltistan had offered submission. The Qing did not occupy these lands and the submission often remained notional. However, Dzungaria and Altishah were occupied and tied to a state based in China. The territory of the Qing Empire had tripled in size. The Qing state was based in China, but to what extent was it a Chinese state? A cohort of so-called new Qing historians have argued persuasively in recent decades that the Qing was not simply another dynasty that had thoroughly assimilated to Chinese culture. Rather, it was an inner Asian empire of conquest, and China was only one part, although a very important part, of a much wider empire. The Qing drew on both inner Asian and Chinese political traditions. In common with any number of inner Asian empires, the Qing took difference for granted and used different methods of rule for different groups of subjects, each of which had an equivalent relationship to the ruling house. The Chinese subjects of the Qing constituted the vast bulk of the population, but they remained only one of several cultural entities in the empire. As James Millward writes, though the empire was centripetal, at the center lay neither an abstract Chinese civilization nor even the Confucian Son of Heaven, but rather the Aixinjuro house, in the person of the many-faceted Qing emperor. The emperor presented himself differently to different groups of his subjects. To Han Chinese, he was the Huangdi, the emperor and the bearer of the mandate of heaven. To Manchus and Mongols, he was a Khan in the inner Asian tradition. And to Tibetans, he was the Chakravartin, the turner of the wheels of Buddhist law. In Muslim Central Asia, the emperor presented himself as a ruler in both Chinggisid and Islamic terms, as the upholder of justice and order. This imperial ideology led to differentiated practices of rule across the empire. In China proper, Neidi, the Qing assimilated the Chinese bureaucracy, examination system and Confucian cosmological order, even as they kept the Han Chinese population at a distance. In Chinese cities, Qing garrisons lived in walled compounds that spatially differentiated them from the local population. In non-Chinese areas, the Qing aspired not to assimilation to a Chinese core, but to the maintenance of power through the recognition of difference. The vast territories of the Dzungar Empire were incorporated into the Qing Empire on these terms. The Qing called the territory they conquered Xinjiang, meaning New Dominion. It was occupied by Manchu and Mongol banner forces and ruled indirectly through local elites. Qing interest was focused on the north, where the steppe provided sufficient fodder for the cavalry and where geopolitical competition with Russia had become an urgent issue. It was the seat of the Ili general, governor of the new territory and leader of the vast bulk of the army of occupation, which numbered around 40,000 until the middle of the 19th century, divided evenly between Manchu and Mongol bannermen and ordinary Han soldiers. The Qing also sponsored the settlement of Chinese peasants on state farms to fill the land that had been left largely unpopulated by the genocide of the Dzungars. Settlers each received 30 mu, about 2 hectares, of land, tools, seeds, a horse, and a loan of 2 silver taels to establish themselves. The response was not overwhelming, but early on, the north emerged as the bastion of Qing power in the region. In the east, the oasis of Kumul and Turfan occupied a special place. They had long historical connections, both commercial and political, with China proper, and their Muslim rulers had submitted to the Qing well before the defeat of the Dzungars. The situation was rather different in the south, which the Qing call Huibu, the Muslim region. The military presence was thinner and largely restricted to troops on three-year rotations. Each oasis was overseen by superintendents, Banshi Dachin, who were answerable to councillors based in Kashgar in Yarkand, and eventually to the Ili general in Gulja. These superintendents were mostly Manchu or Mongol bannermen, and they were concerned primarily with defence. Civil administration, the business of tax collection, adjudication of disputes, supervision of bazaars, was given over to Muslim officials. While the local Muslim population continued to be subject to Islamic law, administered by the Begs and Akhunds. Many of these Muslim officials came from Kumul and Turfan, eastern regions with a longer history of connection to the Qing. Emin Hoxha, the Beg of Turfan, was given the hereditary rank of Junwang, Commandery Prince, and appointed as the first superintendent in Altishar, with headquarters in Yarkand. He was responsible for much of the correspondence with the Qing's outer vassals in the immediate aftermath of the conquest and instrumental in having the remains of the two Hoxhas delivered to Beijing. Under Qing military occupation, Altishar was run by a Muslim elite. Qing power was based in walled fortresses built across Xinjiang. Qing garrisons in China proper were walled off as well. In the north, Qing fortresses grew into substantial towns with a significant Chinese presence. Urumqi developed quite early as a commercial centre. A traveller in 1777 described it as the most prosperous and populated place outside the pass. In the oasis cities of the south, the Qing built fortresses alongside existing cities. These were called new cities, Xingchung, or Manchu cities, Manchung. In Kashgar, the walled compound, built 2 kilometres northwest of the old city, contained barracks, the armoury and government buildings. The walled garrisons were essential for defence, and they also inscribed in space the distinction between the rulers and the ruled. The rulers were Manchu and Mongol, while the ruled were the local Turkic Muslims. Han Chinese occupied a unique place in this dispensation. Chinese peasants were settled in the north. In the south, they came mostly as merchants. Supplying the armies was big business, but Han merchants also acquired interest in retail trade across the region and in the trade with Russia. The Qing did not permit Han merchants to reside permanently in Altishar or to bring their families there with them. This was a mixture of caution, an effort not to destabilize the nascent order by overburdening the compact Muslim populations in relatively densely populated oases, and a lack of interest in the south. Han merchants lived outside the old cities, in or near the citadels built by the Qing.
A significant part of the Chinese population that arrived in Xinjiang was Muslim.
Chinese-speaking Muslims, now called Hui, had formed a distinct community in China for centuries.
In Xinjiang, where they were called Dungan or Tungan in local Turkic, they had a double identity, sharing their faith with the Turkic population of the new frontier and their language with the Han merchants and other settlers.
The Qing considered them a subset of the Han and made them subject to Qing, not Islamic law.
Given that Xinjiang was ruled by Manchu military officials, not the Han, the Dungun did not have a clear intermediary role in the region.
Indeed, they were much closer to Han merchants or peasants, and often served the Qing. Islamic solidarity did not define their relationship to the Turkic-speaking Muslim population of the new Qing frontier. Members of the Turkic Muslim elite bore many different titles, but collectively they were called Wang. The highest ranking among them were regularly received at court in Beijing. Their biographies were included in official records, and their portraits were displayed in the Hall of Purple Radiance in the Forbidden City. The Wangs of Kumul ruled their district as practically autonomous lords, enjoying the rights to the corvée labour of their subjects. Other Wangs were less magnificent, but nevertheless part of the aristocracy of the empire. The system of indirect rule made it possible for local Muslims to imagine that they were still part of an Islamic order. Muslim Wangs presented two different faces to the Qing and to local Muslim society. To the Qing, they spoke in Manchu and later in Chinese and celebrated their subjugation in the vocabulary of Qing ceremonial. To Muslim society, they presented themselves as servants of Islam and seldom mentioned the Qing. After Emin Khoja's death, his son, Suleiman Wang, built a madrasa in Turfan to honour his memory. Its facade bears inscriptions in both Chinese and Turkic. The Chinese inscription openly expresses Emin's status as a returned servant of Emperor Chenglong of the Great Qing. The Turkic inscription makes no mention of the Qing and gives thanks only to God. When the Qing emperor was mentioned in Muslim sources, he was called Khakhan Ichin, the Emperor of China, using a Chinggisid term long indigenized in Central Asia.
Indirect rule made it possible for Muslim elites in Qing, Xinjiang to imagine that they still existed in an Islamic order.
There were also other ways of pretending that Altishar had not been conquered by non-Muslims. Writing at the beginning of the 20th century, Mullah Musa Seyrami asserted that the first Wangs had actually asked for the responsibility from the Qing in the face of local disorder. A number of men had gathered to discuss the crisis in the country, he wrote. Because of the incompetence of the Hojas, the land and the people have been ruined, they argued, and they decided to ask the Khakhan of China for military help. If some troops come and take the government from the Hojas and Altishar becomes part of the Khanate of China, then our land will prosper and our children will be tranquil.
Seven men went to the Khakhan of China to petition for help.
The emperor not only sent a large number of troops to bring order to Altishar, but also rewarded the seven men for their services with high posts and titles. Seyrami also recounted a legend claiming that the emperors of China had been Muslim in the past. Such a construal of history softened the reality of Altishar's incorporation into a non-Muslim empire.
Yet for all that, the legitimacy of Qing rule in Xinjiang remained precarious.
The Begs might project their authority in Islamic and Central Asian terms, but the Qing could never fully co-opt Islamic authority. Discontent with maladministration and abuse of power by both Manchu officers and Muslim Begs combined with anxieties about the fate of Muslim women to fuel a number of rebellions. The first one broke out in the far western town of Ush, or Uchturban, in 1764. The Qing did not allow troops or Chinese merchants to bring their families with them. Prostitution, therefore, flourished, and Qing administrators and banner troops took Muslim women as wives or concubines. In Ush, in 1764, the Qing superintendent Su Cheng and his son were abducting local women, while Abdullah, the local Hakim Beg, extorted money from the population. Su Cheng's dragooning of 240 men to carry his luggage on an official caravan to Beijing sparked a rebellion in which the town's population slaughtered Abdullah, Su Cheng and the Qing garrison. The walled city then held out for several months against a punitive expedition that arrived. Qing vengeance was severe. When the city finally surrendered, some 2,350 men were executed, and about 8,000 women and children were transported to Ili as slaves. Yet many other rebellions followed. Others were to be connected to developments in western Turkestan, beyond the Qing borders.
Chapter 3. Kokand
and Qing silver. One of the petty princes whom Qing generals encountered in their sweep through Central Asia was Erdeni Bey, the ruler of the newly established state of Kokand in the Fergana Valley. Erdeni had little choice but to welcome the Qing envoys and to submit to the Chenlong Emperor. The submission imposed few constraints upon him, however. Indeed, he and his successors used the Qing connection to ensure immense growth that was to make Kokand into a regional power and even allow it to dictate terms in Altishah for a brief period. Kokand had emerged at the beginning of the 18th century in the context of a long-term regional crisis that had weakened the Chinggisid Tukai Timurid dynasty that ruled Bukhara. Chinggisid legitimacy still required a great deal of generosity on the part of the rulers to keep their followers happy. A long-term financial crisis had made it increasingly difficult for the dynasty to keep its non-Chinggisid Uzbek emirs loyal and obedient. The emir's discontent took the form of refusal to remit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.